الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today I'm here with you once again to respond to a video recently released by the individual who calls himself Brother Isma'eel, who was a former apostate from Islam. The title of this video is Proof the Qur'an is Corrupted, Part 1. Relating to the variant readings of the Qur'an. Earlier, I responded to a video he entitled Proof the Qur'an is Incomplete. And in that video, I showed how the argument itself was inconsistent and that it was based upon faulty assumptions. And the logic of Brother Isma'eel oftentimes is that because Muslims say this, and I have disproved the claim of these Muslims, then this is proof that that Islam is false, or proof that the Quran is false. And so he continues with this type of logic in this second video, where he begins by quoting from a book known as The Illustrated Guide to Understanding Islam, written some years ago. And in the book, the authors make a claim that the Quran over the 1400 plus years has not been corrupted. Has not been changed, I'll put it like that. That's what the word utilized in the book, has not been changed. So Brother Isma'eel, he comes in this second video to read to us a number of variant readings of the Qur'an. For instance, he does a comparison between a Hafs Qur'an and a Duri Qur'an. And he, at the end of the video, he talks about how he plans to have a look at the Warif Qur'an as well, as he brings out more of these supposed contradictions or proof that the Qur'an has been changed, that the Qur'an has been changed. Little does he know is that the actual Qur'ans themselves, the very fact that they exist with the variant readings is actually proof of the opposite. At any rate, I hope to clarify that to you very soon. But I think it's important for us to speak a little bit about history here so that we can understand the history of the Qur'an, how it was compiled, among other things. Upon the death of the Prophet Muhammad, the Qur'an itself was not gathered into a single book, into a single place. Rather, during his life, every time something was revealed, the verses of the Qur'an were written down by scribes and then stored and perhaps in their homes, and they were perhaps sometimes with the Prophet himself. The Prophet didn't see any need, apparently, during his lifetime to bring together those pages into a single book or in a single place. During the reign of the first caliph, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu, a battle had occurred and a number of the people who had memorized the Quran had fallen on the battlefield. So he was encouraged to bring the pages of the Quran together into a single place out of fear that the knowledge of the Quran would be lost through the knowledge of the through the loss of these particular scholars or Quran memorizers. Two caliphs later, after the reign of Umar ibn Khattab and then into the reign of Uthman ibn Affan, a new controversy had erupted where a number of the Muslims, new Muslims in particular, who were not Arabs, found themselves, challenged by the different ways that the Quran was being read or recited by different people or their different teachers. And so when some of them had heard the rendition of the other students or the other, which they got from their teachers, from the Sahaba, they would reject them and say, well, I don't believe that's from the Quran. And Hudhayfa ibn Yaman, a companion, he came to Uthman ibn Affan and complained that you should catch this ummah before they differ about the Book of Allah in the same way or to the extent that the Jews and Christians differ about their book. You know, which is a fact. You know, they differ about the book. No, Muslims' differences about the books is nowhere compared to the level of difference and discrepancy about the books as Christians. You know, and I'll come back to that later on because Brother Isma'eel made reference to David Wood. So we're going to come back to that in a second. During this period, the early period, when the Prophet was alive, he had said at one particular point, in the Quran, unzila ala sab'ati ahruf, faqra'u ma tayassara min, that the Quran has been revealed upon seven ahruf. So read whichever is easy. So the word ahraf in the hadith I haven't translated because scholars have differed about exactly what's intended by the ahraf in this particular statement. The Quran was revealed upon seven languages, or seven dialects, or seven ways, seven letters, seven different letters. So different possibilities of translation, and there actually are up to 40 different opinions about what is exactly intended by this hadith. But all of the scholars who differ, they agree upon one point, and that is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the ahraf, had something to do with a certain type of leniency which was given to the early period, to the early community, for them to recite the Quran in a certain way. And for this very reason, the majority of the scholars are of the view that the seven ahraf is a reference to seven dialects of the Quran. So for instance, one particular clan known as Banu Hudayl, they had trouble reciting or pronouncing the letter ha. Their ha was a, was ayn. So instead of reciting in Surah Hatta'in, they were allowed to say Atta'in. So that's just one particular example. Now, so this is significant when we think about the issue of variant readings. As we move into the reign of Uthman ibn Affan, who then standardizes the text of the Quran because of these different readings that existed in the class between different readings and people rejecting the readings of other people, even accusing one another of disbelief or unbelief because of them believing that someone was adding to the Quran or omitting from the Quran something which did not belong there. So Uthman had, he standardized the text, he got rid of six of the ahraf, and he retained one. And he, when it was retained, the way that the script was written, it was written in such a way to preserve the possibilities of reciting in different fashions. So the variant readings that Brother Isma'eel speaks about, they were preserved in the actual way that it was written and recorded down by Uthman, his particular campaign, and before the particular Masahib, which were copied, and they were sent out to the different parts of the Muslim Ummah. So for instance, in Surah Al-Fatiha, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says Maliki Yawmiddin or Maliki Yawmiddin, if you look in the a Mus'haf that preserves the Uthmani script, that you find it be written as Mim Lam Kaf. Mim Lam Kaf. And it remains Mim Lam Kaf because the scholars wanted to preserve the possibility to read it as Malik, meaning king, or Malik, owner. Right. So they would, as they read, they would add the mud, or they would add the elongation to the reading. And you will find this all throughout the Quran and the Uthmani script. So for instance, as well, kalimatu rabbika or kalimatu rabbika, it'll be written as kaf la mim ta. Sometimes an open ta, sometimes a closed ta. But kaf lam mim ta, not kaf lam mim alif ta in that particular version, but kaf lam mim ta, because it can be kalimatu rabbika or kalimatu rabbika, right? I will add to this that during this particular period, the Quran and the Mus'haf and the transcription of the Quran did not include vowels and dots. So you couldn't distinguish between ba, ya, ta, or anything else like that. The Sahaba themselves could. They knew when they read what they had written down, what particular vowels were supposed to go there, what consonants were supposed to go there. So this is the Quran as it was revealed, and that was given to the Prophet, and that was given to the Sahaba, and passed down. It was only a later development, such as the contributions of people such as Abu Aswad Du'ali and Khalid ibn Ahmad Farahidi, that we now have the standardized vowelization of the Quran and the different distinction between a seen or a sheen or dad and a sod and dad or ta and dha. All right, so some of them have dots, others do not have dots. That was a later development, right? So if we're talking about alterations to the text, that there's been no alterations to the text other than additions of vowels and dots to make it easy for non-Arabs to actually easily read what particular qira'ah or rendition they're given. So the idea, the claim that the Quran, this is proof, or the fact that variant readings exist is proof that the Quran has been changed, right, is a false claim. Right, it's a false claim, you know, because there has been this way from the very beginning, right? So the text didn't have vowels, didn't have dots, and they were always subject and open to variant readings. Sometimes a verb may have, may be in the singular, or it may be in the plural. Sometimes it may be in the active voice. Sometimes it may be in the passive voice. But none of that affects the ultimate meaning of the actual verses. So one particular claim that Brother Isma'eel makes is that the fact that in one verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, yukafiru, and in another reading, another version of the Quran, it says, nukafiru, right? And let's say version for the sake of argument. He wants to call them versions, the different versions of the Quran. So nukafiru, some say, God, he will expiate your sins, or others, God, we will expiate your sins. He said that this is a theological conundrum or a problem of theology. This is a theological issue. And Muslims would argue, no, it doesn't produce any theological issue, especially when we take into consideration that Brother Isma'eel has inappropriately characterized the understanding of Muslims when we say that the we, when Allah says we, that is a royal we or a we of majesty, right? Or jalala, or the Arabs would say it is the plurality of ta'ziman, of ta'zim and nafs. It is the plurality of a person, of one who actually magnifies himself. And for this very reason, when Muslims greet one another, they say assalamu alaykum, rather than assalamu alayka or assalamu alayki, because it's done out of respect, you know. So because kum is like is a plural, peace be upon you all, even though it's an individual we're speaking to, but we're doing it to show respect to the individual that we're speaking to. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is magnifying himself. And in the English language, we have something called the royal we. Well, monarchs, when they spoke, they would speak in the plural. We have decreed, we have decided, we have ordered, we have forbade. And they actually meant me, I have done so. And so Allah is speaking to the Arabs in their own language, utilizing their own type of constructs and to magnify the creativity and the beauty of their own language and use it against them to as a rhetorical device. That largely, that's all it is. It's no theological implication in it. And to claim that it is indicative of a multiplicity of powers, that in itself is shirk. That in itself is idolatry, because Muslims say about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah is wahidun fi dhatihi wa fi sifatihi wa fi af'ali, that he is one in his essence, and one in his attributes, and one in his actions, right? So you throw that at a Mu'tazili, and a Mu'tazili will perhaps do more than simply call you a kafir, you know, because the idea that God is a multiplicity is something that all the Muslim sects, they negate, they deny, and also the idea that God's attributes are a multiplicity as well, in itself is considered to be idolatry. So no Muslim believes that God has multiple powers, right? So this idea, the question of which God is more powerful, the one who speaks in the plural, the one who speaks singular. It's like, well, it doesn't have any theological bearing at all. And if anything, it would be shirk if you would say that God is speaking as a multiplicity, right? No, God is speaking in a way that a monarch would speak in English, right? You know, except God does not have he has the highest and most sublime similitude, as we would say, as the Quran says as well. So those are some of the issues. And then another issue I like to highlight as well is that whether you say that God, that he expiates sins or we expiate sins, they mean the same thing for Muslims, you know, so there's no theological issue. But I did want to bring up a reference that Brother Isma'eel had made to Surah Al-Baqarah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks and says, وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْذِبُونَ, and they have a painful punishment because they used to lie. And then another reading, وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْذِبُونَ, and they have a painful punishment because they used to be lie, right? Or they consider someone to be a liar, right? And so this is also the reading of Warsh, you know. So Brother Isma'eel, as you go and read Warsh, you'll see the same thing. يَكْذِبُونَ is just like duri, but Hafs it reads يَكْذِبُونَ. And so he claims that here is a contradiction, right? This idea that so God is going to punish people because in one narration because they lie, he's going to punish them because they lie, or he's going to punish them because they be lie. And there's no contradiction, because one, God punishes because you lie and because you be lie. Secondly, because this particular verse is a reference back to an earlier verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ, and from the people are those who say we believe in Allah in the last day, but they really don't believe. right? So when God threatens with the punishment, he says they'll be punished because they lie. They lie about what? They lie when they say we believe in Allah on the last day, but they truly don't believe. And he punishes them because they belie Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because if they say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we believe in Allah on the last day, and he calls them to believe in Allah on the last day, but they really don't believe, then they consider Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be a liar, right? So there is no contradiction at all. You see, it's a contradiction is in your mind. You know, there's no contradiction in the verse at all, right? So think about those issues. Remember that the Quran in this early period did not contain vowels or dots, right? So the same Quran that was given to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the same one that we have, and especially the one that we find, which is preserves the Uthmani script to this very day. The very fact that sometimes a verb is in the active voice, in the passive voice, or that it's a singular or plural doer doesn't contradict or lead to any special theological problems. You know, and since you're reading the Wadish Quran, you'll be reading the Wadish Quran right now, I like to bring to your attention one particular verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Hafs Quran says, وَجَعَلُوا مَلَائِكَةَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ إِنَاثًا, and they made the angels who are the servants of God female. And the Hafs reading, it says, وَجَعَلُوا مَلَائِكَةَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عِنْدَ الرَّحْمَنِ إِنَاثًا, and they made the angels who are with the All-Merciful One feminine, right? So again, you'll probably say, oh, contradiction. You know, so is it ibad or is it indah? Is it ibad or is it indah? Right? So is it fervence or is it with? Right? So, but remember, again, once again, the Mus'haf of Uthman, when it was written down, there were no vowels and there were no dots. And it was three seats there. There's a seat for the ayn, there's a seat for the ba, and there's a seat for the dal. Right? And that middle radical, that middle seat was empty with no dots on it. It could potentially be a noon or it could potentially be a ba. And if it's a ba, it could be the ba. And since they typically do not add the letter of mud or extension, they wouldn't say ibad after ayn ba alif dal, but just simply add an elongated mudda sign over the ba, and it becomes ibad, right, or inda, right? And both of those readings were passed down from the early period, and they're preserved from the time of Uthman ibn Affan, radiallahu an, right? So consider that as well, right? Lastly, I would like to, again, just make bring up the very fact that that Brother Ismail makes mention of David Wood, which seems to reveal that either Brother Ismail, as I stated before in the earlier video, that he's either a Christian missionary or he's a proxy for Christian missionaries. David Wood himself is an anti-Muslim propagandist among the Christians, and he spends more of his time trying to prove the validity of Christianity or the truth of Christianity by undermining the validity of Islam, you know, instead of asking people to accept Christianity on its own merits, you know, so people have to be driven to these sort of extremes, right? And so Ismail's logic is that, well, if I can prove that the Quran is corrupted, then the Quran must not be from God. We apply the same logic to the Bible. We apply the same logic to the Bible and anything. There's more reason for us to say that the Bible is not from God, because there's much, 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 much more corruption and so many more contradictions in the Bible than you ever find in the Quran. You won't find any contradiction in the Quran. You'll only find something in your brain that tells you there's a contradiction, right? You know, but there are clear contradictions in the Bible, you know. So the fact that there's corruption in the Bible should prove to you that the Bible is not from God. But I'm not one of the people who would say that the Bible does not have a divine origin. You know, I'm not one of those people who says that. You know, I believe there definitely has been some corruption, actual in the text, perhaps in simply the teachings themselves. It all depends on how you read it. There's a difference between the theology of John and the theology of the other New Testament writers. Yeah, so that's an important consideration, important thing to consider when we look at Brother Ismail and look at his videos. You know, what is he really calling us to? If we call us away from Islam, what is he ultimately calling us to? If he's not a Christian, then perhaps he's an atheist. Perhaps he wants to call us into atheism, you know, and so there's no happiness there either, you know, for anyone who may be searching for happiness and searching for certainty. But the Quran is the best option you have in terms of authenticity of a claim of a divine book. And so So this is what I leave you with today. Brother Isma'eel has not proven that the Quran is corrupted. All he has proven is that he has discovered what Muslim scholars have always known, which is that the Quran has been read in different ways and they have variant readings from the very beginning. It's exactly why they preserve them. It's exactly why they those particular variants were published. And it's exactly for that reason that Brother Isma'eel can hold in his hand a copy of Hafs and a copy of Duri and a copy of Warsh, you know, had it not been for Muslim scholars being dedicated and honest about the variant readings of the Quran. So the fact that there are variant readings of the Quran does not prove that the Quran has been changed. So the claim of the book of the guided, the illustrated guide of understanding Islam is a true claim, and Brother Isma'eel's claim is false. And lastly, I'll say that stop trying to set up a straw man argument where you may discover a Muslim says one thing, and so, and if you disprove the Muslim's claim, then that itself also automatically means Islam is untrue, or Islam is false, because the Muslim's claim was false, right? Because Islam is not equated with what a Muslim says. So if a Muslim comes with a false claim, you can refute their claim, but that doesn't necessarily prove that Islam is false. So everyone, I say to you, have a nice day, and hopefully there's some benefit that comes to you from this video. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.